evening, I have been charged by having been two duties. The first, to thank you all very much for coming this evening. The second, to say a few words about Steve. I was at university with Steve and knew him quite well then. We shared a room for a year. But my view of him is very partial, just a bit of Steve. But I hope that some of it will chime with yours. I'm going to say a bit about certain Steve-ish qualities that seem to be very important and very valuable. And the first is to say that Steve was in many ways a very brave and bold person. He wasn't set about by rules of convention or orthodoxy. He didn't mind doing things that were not the way things were done, if there were better ways. He wasn't much set around by rules of what was good taste, what was bad taste, what was good dress, what was bad dress, what you could ask for, what you couldn't ask for. He had an entrepreneurial streak, very valuable for us all to have people like that. He had that quality. He was also a very quick person, quick in many ways. Quick with ideas, quick with sums, quick with words, quick at seeing the interconnections between ideas and things. And that made him playful. He loved people. He loved talking to people. He spoke to people so quickly. He got to know them so quickly. He was very quick at reading people. And he was very quick to find the areas in which their interests and excitements intersected with his interests and excitements. So that he was a fantastic networker, the center of many networks that connected people together with him as a hub point. Now that combination of quickness and not minding about convention and of enjoying people led to the jokes, I think, the puns in particular, which were, I think, the heart of many of his jokes. And the puns were always fashioned especially as for the people they were made for. Most people will have a story about Steve that ends up with everybody weeping with laughter. And that was a common experience for all of us. I will do you one Steve story. At some stage in our mathematical life together, studying together, somebody in our common lecture theatre, somebody who was in charge of the mathematics program, unwisely put up a piece of paper asking for feedback and comments, suggestions for ways in which the course could be improved. And one of my colleagues wrote saying they thought it would be a good idea to start a lecture course on something called category theory, which is a rather highfalutin bit of pure mathematics. This was a suggestion that some people thought was a good idea, and some people didn't, because they thought category theory was mostly a way of saying obvious things in a complicated way. And one of them wrote saying, I disagree with this. Category theory is all trivial, at least until you get to the Yoneda lemma. Yoneda was a Japanese mathematician who came up with this result. And the next morning I came in and the handwriting that I knew very well had appeared on this sheet, and it now said, you need a lemma? I've got a lemma. It was struck at the time as extreme funny, have ever since, and is now the only thing I can remember about categories. Going to music, he loved being in music, he loved great music. And one of the rituals that was important was before going off to an exam, you had to sit and listen to the last movement of the Jupiter Symphony. But he also loved bad music, naff music, badly performed music. He didn't mind as long as it had something. It had heart or it had some sort of joy in it. something that amused him. He had found some terrible LP that had been put together by Kenny Everett, the worst songs ever played. We used to weep with laughter over. And he somewhere or other acquired a piece of music that is a theme and variations on the Brazilian national anthem, which I've been trying to find ever since and haven't, but was thrilled last year at the Olympics when the Brazilians won one of the judo gold medals, and it really was the Brazilian national anthem. At the heart of things, Steve cared very much about people. It wasn't just networking with them and connecting them up and realizing what made them tick. He minded about them, about his family and his friends, very much. And that combination of qualities meant that he was a very good person to turn to in a crisis. And he was a support for many people about that. And I think probably what drew him to things like working as a pharmacist, or ultimately to working in the Department of Health and trying to keep the NHS in one piece. Those things were important to him. So, when I, in one of our years, our birthdays were roughly similar times of years, and we had a joint birthday party where we celebrated 48 combined years of life. And I realized that next year I will get to that total on my own. And it's very sad for me that Steve won't be there, and it will be very sad for all of you in your many and various ways that he's not here. But I hope you will see in some of the music happening tonight various of the aspects that you will remember and love about Steve and enjoy it. Thank you very much indeed.
Oh. greatest operas, because Steve was an enormous opera lover. And that chorus is a morning chorus. There's a kind of shape to the music this evening, as I've seen towards the end. So it's very much a feeling of morning, of freshness and openness. And it's a beautiful, beautiful piece, as you've heard. I'm going to invite Susanna now to introduce the next piece.
Which is Caro Nome, Gilda's aria from the beginning of Rigoletto. Gilda is a young, very overprotected girl, and she's met the eyes across the church of the Duke. And finally, he's crept into the garden, their private garden, and told her that his name is Gualtier Maldi, which is in fact not even his name, it's a lie. But she sings this whole aria to this name, Caro Nome, dear name, and she swears that she'll be true to him forever.
Oh!
suggested that some Philip Glass might be nice, but Steve was a great fan of Philip Glass's operas. It reminded me that one day, 15 years ago, a package arrived through my door. Any time I think Steve ever sent me a parcel, and it was unannounced and unrequested. And it contained two cassette tapes containing the whole of a Philip Glass called Satyagraha. So I can't remember precisely what the little note said, but basically it said, this is the best thing ever written, you've got to listen to it. And so I put it on, and I started for a bit, and I gradually sort of snoozed off, really. Philip Glass is a collector's item, it's not for everyone. And actually, I then didn't really listen to it for about 15 years, until I remembered I still had this thing. And indeed, that's the music you just we're hearing at the beginning, it's actually the tape that Steve made for me. And now I realize it's actually rather obvious music, but it took a lot of time for me to. It's just one of the only other things Steve ever sent me, in terms of, you must listen to this, was one of the other sort of pieces that Andy was talking about earlier, on the bad taste side. There's something called The Legend Sings in Latin. And it was an entire album of Elvis Presley songs sung in Latin.
There was a wonderful polystyrene wall constructed for the hall of Babylon. And on at the dress rehearsal, this wall actually fell on the orchestra. Quite an event. Anyway, Carmen, this is, I'm sure everybody knows Carmen, this is the beginning of Act Two. Gypsy song, you've got your maracas and your pockets and maracas. Castanets! Play them or sing along or stuff if you can.
Monte, 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 Monte.
I've never forgotten, and when Andy said about Steve's delighting puns, I
remember that very strongly. So I'm going to sing the second half of the letter scene from Tchaikovsky's Eugene Onegin, because the whole thing is incredibly long, and probably more than you need to hear. I'm rather crashy decided to sing it in Russian by Ben Kim. I asked which language, and he said Russian. So if anyone speaks Russian, please forgive me for the occasional mistake of emphasis. But it does sound fabulous in Russian. Let me tell you very, very quickly what she says. She says she's writing to a man who she met yesterday for the first time. And she takes one look at him and goes, "You are Mr. Wright. I know you are. Just no question, you're definitely the one for me." And she decides to write him a letter to tell him that he is the one for her. And she's a bit nervous about it. She makes a few false starts. And then she decides, "No, I really am going to do this. I'm going to write to him and tell him." And she says, "I saw you. It wasn't a dream. I knew that you were the one. You were the one who's always been there for me, the one who I was aware of when I was praying, when I was doing things I felt good about, giving, helping the poor. You were, it's as if you were here, standing here, while I'm writing to you, even though actually you're off in the next house." And then she, at the heart of it, there's this very simple, very beautiful phrase where she says, "But are you my guardian angel? Or are you just temptation? Will you support me and love me, or will you discard me?" And she decides that whatever she does, she is going to commit herself and say, tell him that she loves him, however frightening it is. She finishes the letter. She thinks, "I'm not going to read it through. I'm just going to send it and believe that he will honour my bravery, my courage in writing to him."
Thank you.
These chaps behind me, very close friends of mine and of students. Most of the performers you've heard are here this evening. Sam and Steve, different combinations, all very good friends. It's been a delight to present music for this evening. This is a particular favourite number of Steve's. Don't know why particularly. It's a good rollicking tune. In a way, because it's got Steve written all over it. It's from what's called a semi-opera by the great English composer Henry Purcell, King Arthur. And it's a song for some blokes.
Your pay is mowed and your corn is reaped. Your barns will be full and your hovels heaped. Come, boys, come, come, boys, come, and merrily roar out the harvest home. And merrily roar out the harvest home. Harvest home, harvest home, and merrily roar out the harvest home. And merrily roar out the harvest home. We've cheated the possibility. Cheat him again, for why should a blockhead have one in ten? One in ten, one in ten. For why should a blockhead have one in ten? For why should a blockhead have one in ten?
Oh.
You are the